Hey you guys, it's Peter, and today we're gonna do something completely different on my channel, but something that I am equally as passionate about. So, I have been kind of slowly feeding this video, hinting at it over the past couple weeks, but September is National Recovery Month. It is something that is recognized every year by SAMHSA, which is the Substance Abuse and Mental Health Association. And they put it on every year to recognize and bring attention to addiction and sobriety and recovery, you know, and a very important topic in our world today, and personally something that's very, very close to my heart. If you watch my videos on a regular basis, you know that I got sober at 22 years old. My mother got sober 6 months after I did, and I have dedicated the last 20 years of my life to working with addicted people, mostly teenagers and young adults. So I just need to say that before I go into this video, because I think a lot of times on my drama videos or when I give suggestions to people and I say, hey, I don't think this is funny or this is a very serious topic, a lot of times people are kind of confused about where that comes from for me. And you know, it's just such a personal issue. And over 20 years, what I have learned is one thing, that I have never come into contact with somebody whose lives were not impacted on some level, whether it's from a family member, a spouse, a sibling, a child, a coworker, a neighbor, what, an uncle, an aunt, whatever, okay, by addiction. And it could be anything from drinking all the way to shooting heroin to whatever the issue is. You know, pills are taking over our country right now. Oxycontin is one of the harshest drugs on our street. You know, people ask me all the time, are you a big supporter of Suboxone, which is, you know, a maintenance drug to get people off of these drugs? And I'm not, because I've seen so many opiate addicts use these drugs and then they manipulate them. And it's just, to me, it's just one sadness after another after another. I wish I could tell you in the last 20 years how many funerals I have attended as a result of overdoses or lives lost in relation to something to do with drugs and alcohol. It's countless. It's beyond belief. And there's one thing I really never joke about, and that is about addiction. Now, sometimes I will joke, like on my vlog, if you watch my daily vlog, it's listed below, Peter Vlogs. You know, mostly it's me driving around and just talking. And a lot of times on there, I will tell kind of like funny stories of things that happened in the past. But with that being said, it's also very important for me to talk about and stress the seriousness and the importance of addiction in our country right now. And it's a really serious issue for a couple reasons. Number one, most people don't have money for drug and alcohol treatment. Number two, most insurance companies will not pay for drug and alcohol treatment, or they will pay for a very short-term detox, like 1 or 2 days, and then shoot that person into an outpatient program with absolutely no resources whatsoever, no resources for the family. So basically, we have this very raw drug addict or alcoholic that's back on the streets and has no idea how to take care of themselves. And that, luckily, is not my story. So, like I said, I got sober when I was 22 years old, and I just kind of wanted to share my story today. I'm thinking about making a video sometime next week. Let me know in the comment sections if this would be interesting to you, on how to find an appropriate treatment program or what to do if you're like, I want to get sober, but I don't know where there are resources or they're too expensive or whatever, because I find that I get messages. I mean, even in the last 24 hours, I've gotten 3 messages like that. Like, I'm seeking treatment, but I can't find one that's low cost. They don't have treatment in my area. The closest 12-step meeting is 3 hours away. I mean, I hear it all the time on a daily basis, and it breaks my heart, you know? And it makes me very, very grateful to live in a metropolitan city like Indianapolis, where there are 12-step programs or 12-step meetings from several different programs, you know, all through the day and late into the night. There are countless treatment programs, of which I know because I just went and looked, and I also knew that, but I wanted to tell you a little bit about my story. So I got sober at 22 years old, but my use history actually goes back much further than that. And I started drinking when I was about 12 years old. I always knew that I wanted to be an alcoholic. And I know that sounds strange, but I've often thought about writing a book about my mother and I's addiction together and our interlapping and overlapping recoveries. Because my mother, I would call the pretty drinker. And what I mean by that is that, you know, she would get everything she needed to get done for the day. And then at night, she would sit around and she would play out like record albums like Fleetwood Mac and, you know, Janis Joplin and Bob Dylan. And she would sit in our library and she would smoke cigarettes and drink. And I thought that looked so glamorous. And she would have friends over and they would play loud music and dance. And, you know, she put the music or the speakers in the what do you call it? The windows for outside, and she'd sit on the front porch and drink beer while the kids were playing in the cul-de-sac. And there was something very alluring about that. And what I know today is that I was born with a predisposition for addiction. And I was born with this longing for something more, that there was always an emptiness inside of me. There was always this, I never fit in. I was always on the fringe looking in, but I was never a part of. I never felt included, right? So flash forward to 12 years old, and I go with a good friend of mine and these two girls to our elementary school down the street, and it's late at night, and we're swinging, and we brought alcohol, and all three of them get incredibly sick. And I'm just swinging and I'm thinking, the stars are bright. This is magical. I can't wait to do this again. And this is a common thing you'll hear with a lot of people that are alcoholics or addicts. I can't wait to do that again, right? And from there, it was off to the races. And I drank any chance I got. You know, I stole alcohol all the time from my parents, especially my father, and I hid it in my bedroom. I would drink alone in my bedroom at my dad's house when I was there on weekends. I was very much like a 40-year-old alcoholic at 13, 14, 15. Even my friends in high school, I don't think had really any kind of idea how much I was drinking, because I loved to sit at home and drink and watch movies late at night. And when you're younger, you know, you're not getting hangovers the same way that you would before. And it got to be really, really bad, to the point where I would say by the time I was 17, I was a daily drinker. And hiding it pretty well from everybody around me. I mean, people really had no clue that it was that bad. Now, I did get in trouble with the law. I did get in trouble with the school. I did go through numerous treatment programs. And when I was 22, I got sober for the last time. I have done my time in jail. Baby, my past is not pretty, okay? And I talk a lot about this on my vlog. I'm not proud of the things I did. I took a lot of risks. I did a lot of things for my addiction that I put myself in a lot of really scary places that I cannot believe that I am sitting here today and I am alive and I am well, and I am so thankful for that. And I'm very, very grateful for the life I have today. I had no clue how bad it was. I really didn't. And something very rapidly happened from 18 to 22. But by the time that I was 22, I was drinking a fifth and a half of Jack Daniels a day, 2 to 3 Colt 45s with malt liquor. I was smoking probably, like an eighth of marijuana a day. I was using, a gram of cocaine a day, as well as smoking raw cocaine. I was taking probably 4 to 10 Vicodin a day, and I was addicted across the board. There were other things. I mean, I would take anything that anybody gave me. I just didn't want to feel. I was terrified of my future. I had no idea what I was doing. I had been bullied my entire life growing up, but I was not going to give that power and say that the reason that I had all these issues with drinking and drugs was because I was bullied. Because I was like, oh no, I don't have a problem with being gay. I don't have a problem with it at all. And I think in retrospect, what I know now is that being gay and coming out at eight, I came out on my 18th birthday, was much more of a problem than I ever had any kind of clue. I think I still, even coming out, didn't feel a part of. I didn't feel included. I've always, my entire life, and I can tell you that even sitting on this camera today, I feel separate from, and I've had to learn just even in the last 6 months that if I really want to be a part of something, I have to force myself to be a part of that. I'm very involved in a 12-step program in Indianapolis. And, you know, that's for me, and it makes me feel like I'm a part of something, but even then I have to force myself out of my social anxiety, and I've talked a lot about my social anxiety on my vlog, to go and do those things because they're better for me. When I was 22 years old, my dad really, he knew something was off, but I didn't see him that often. My mother was wrapped up in her own addiction, and all of my friends had kind of left my side at that point. I was in college. I had dropped out for my second semester in a row to use the money towards my addiction. I mean, not consciously, but I knew I didn't have any money to survive, so I would like sign up for classes, my dad would pay for them, I'd drop them, pocket the check, and then that's how I was living. He was furious when he found out about that. And that just was a downhill spiral until the night of December 16th, 1994. I was going downtown to see a friend of mine. I had been drinking and using all day long. I remember I got up that morning and I actually wrote a whole blog entry about this. I'll post it below. It's called like 2 Degrees of Insanity or something. You guys can go check it out if you want. It's on my old blog that I don't ever post on anymore. But I woke up that morning, you know, I was watching Charlie Brown's Christmas, just a typical day in the house. I used to mix in the mornings vodka and Pepto-Bismol because my stomach hurt so bad. What I found out later was that I had some serious stomach problems related to my drinking at 22 years old. I would probably be like long dead by now if I had continued to drink. So I got up that morning, I was smoking weed all day long, getting ready, and what would happen is by 8 o'clock that night when I would go hang out with my friends, you know, they had worked all day or they had gone to school, and when they would see me come through the door, I had been drinking, using, eating pills all day long. You'd think I'd be a mess, but it took all of that just for me to look okay. The Peter you see on camera today does not look like the Peter that I was back then. And so anyway, I went downtown. I came back up north. I went to another bar. I remember smoking crack in the alleyway with somebody, I don't know who. And I remember leaving and I went to a friend's house and then he fell asleep. He took my keys. I stole my keys back from him and a bunch of beer. And I left. And the next thing I knew, I was driving through the back kitchen of a Perkins restaurant, and which is like a Denny's if you don't know what a Perkins is. And that was it. And then my dad came out there. I called my dad because I was like, who else is... He's my chief enabler. He'll come and whatever. He was so done at that point. He came out at 5 o'clock in the morning on this snowy, snowy night that was bitter cold. And he had a suit on because he knew that he was about to deal with the law or going to the hospital or something where he had been many times. I had been hit by a van going 50 miles an hour, handed on my head. I had been arrested numerous, numerous times. I had more accidents, health issues than I can tell you about. I mean, my family later told me that they were terrified every day that they were going to get a call that I was dead. So he said to me, he got in his car and he said, you can go to, I had plea bargained down 2 Class D felonies. And so he knew that I was probably going to be doing some jail time. He goes, you can go to prison or you can go to treatment, but I'm done with you. And he goes, I will pay for one more treatment and that is it. I'm done. Well, I'm no stupid addict, so I went to treatment, right? That's what you do. That's what you do when you're a stupid when you're not a stupid addict, right? Because you think you got it all figured out. So I went into treatment. I tested positive on everything across the board, and I blew a 0.47, and I hadn't drank in like 6 hours. 6 or 8 hours. When I woke up the next morning, I don't even know what to say about how I felt. I was on the detox unit. I walked out and the woman that had been my neighbor for the last 15 years growing up was the detox nurse. I didn't even know she worked at this facility. And I looked at her and I said, yeah, I need to get out of here. And she goes, no, she goes, you're really sick. And she took my hand and she said, Peter, she goes, you're going to end up dead if you keep on using. And I was like, no. And she handed me my pack of cigarettes that apparently they had confiscated. And she said, go smoke a cigarette, get a cup of coffee and stay. She was like, you're going to end up dead. I called every friend of mine in the world to come pick me up. It was the middle of a blizzard. All of my friends, my dad had already reached out to and said, if you care about Peter at all, don't have any contact with him. Hang up as soon as he calls you. Every person I called hung up on me. When I called my mother, he had told her, he'll manipulate you. Don't come get him. I called my mom, and as soon as she answered the phone, she was bawling, and she said, I can't talk to you, and she hung up the phone. So I was stuck in treatment, and I had to do what I had to do, and my biggest fear was that I was afraid of being homeless. I was terrified beyond belief of being homeless because I had never really had a real job other than, you know, dealing drugs and other kinds of illegal behaviors. I didn't know how to take care of myself. I had no clue what to do. My car was in my dad's name. My apartment was in my dad's name. I was terrified. If he had any clue the sketchy ass places I had put myself in the last 3 years, I mean, I don't know. Like, I look back on that and I think it just was like all timing that it happened the way that it happened. So I stayed and I went through treatment. And my first week, all I thought about was how I'm going to get out of here. My second week, I learned to shut my mouth enough so that nobody paid me any attention because all the counselors were looking at me like he's the one that's trouble. The third week they moved me from rehab to residential, and I was sitting in there and I started listening because I thought what they're saying to me is me, and I'm hearing my stories and the stories that other people are telling me, and I started getting scared. And on the fourth week of treatment, I was terrified to leave because I knew that I couldn't do it on my own. And my counselor hooked me up with a sponsor. She found 12-step meetings for me to go to. She got me a counselor to go to once I got out of there and an aftercare program. And I told my dad I couldn't go to school right away. I needed some time off. He said, that's fine. He goes, I'll support you for 6 months. But after that 6 months, you need to either get a full-time job or go back to school. And I'm not paying for either one of those. He was done paying for anything. So my schedule when I got out of treatment looked like this. I went to a meeting every day, sometimes twice a day for the first year. I went to aftercare one day a week. I saw my counselor twice a week. I talked to my sponsor every day on the phone, and I was hanging out with only recovery people. The three friends I still had, I called and said I couldn't hang out with them anymore, and they just laughed. My mother, I called, and I said, I can't continue to be around people, places, and things that will get me using. And she said, you surely can't be talking about me. And I said, yeah, you're included in that. My mom got sober 6 months later to that date. And if she were alive today, she would have 6 months less than me. And she died 1 month short of her 13th birthday in sobriety. I never thought my mother would be the person that would ever get sober. For her to be a woman that was respected in the rooms of 12-step programs in Indianapolis, to see roomfuls of women that were sober sitting by her side in the hospital as she died, to speak the language of recovery with my mother for 12 years and 11 months, was absolutely amazing. It was the greatest gift she could have ever given me. And in return, the best gift that I could have ever given her was to never drink or drug again, as well as my father. And that's really all I have to do for my parents to be proud of me today, is to take care of my own shit and my job and stay sober and not be an embarrassment to everybody else, you know? And that's not a lot to ask. And, you know, as a result of that, for the last 22 years, I've kind of done the same thing on a daily basis. I have gone to meetings and called my sponsor, and I have, you know, helped other people and done service, and I have gone and continued to talk to counselors when I needed to, and I've worked in the field of addiction, which isn't necessary, but it was amazing, and I met such amazing kids and their parents through the years, and it was just such a life force, you know? It was just, it's been such an amazing life. And today, at 22 years and 9 months sober, I'm married. All of my friends and family members know that I'm sober. They're very respectful of that. I go to a lot of meetings. I'm very active in a 12-step program. I have tons of friends that are sober. My life is full. I have 4 YouTube channels. I've written a book, and I could never be happier in my entire life. There are shit days that happen to me on a regular basis, because just because you get sober doesn't mean life is going to be amazing. It doesn't, okay? But just because I stayed drinking doesn't mean, or drugging doesn't mean, that things weren't going to get better either. I mean, I could have still had those same shit things happen. And one of the greatest things that ever happened to me was that I was able to be present for my mother's illness and her death. And it was a privilege to be by her side and hold her hand sober, with her sober in her last moments. I don't want to miss out on moments like that, because it's too important for me to drink, or it's too important for me to get fucked up, or it's too important for me to smoke weed to get wasted and out of my mind, because I don't want to feel, or I just want to party, or I'm so selfish and self-centered that all I can think about is myself, when people around me are affected by the choices that I make. I have such an amazing life today, and if I had to prioritize for you everything that I have, from my husband, to my dogs, to my house, to my career, to my writing books, to my being a YouTuber, to everything on there, number one would be my sobriety. Because if I don't have my sobriety, then I don't have anything else. On a daily basis, people reach out to me and they tell me about what they're going through with their own recoveries. People tell me that they've stayed sober for 2 months or 3 months or 6 years, or that they're going to treatment in a couple weeks. And I always try to be so encouraging. So if you're out there and you're watching this and you don't think that it could happen for you, you're talking to somebody, you're looking at somebody that never thought that they could stay sober for one day, let alone 1 hour. When I first got sober, I would keep a list on the counter of all of the people that I had met in sobriety and their phone numbers. And on the left-hand side, I would keep a list of all of my drug dealers and think, the liquor store is one block down the street. And I would look at the clock and I would say to myself, okay, it's 9:45. If I can just make it till 10, I can go drink at 10 or call one of my dealers. And I would call all these people over on the right-hand side until I got a hold of somebody. And they would always talk me out of it. And I would keep on doing that over and over. When I first got sober, I had to stay sober an hour at a time, a minute at a time, a day at a time, literally. And it was the most valuable thing that ever happened to me. I had no idea. I thought when I got sober, it just meant that I wasn't gonna use drugs and alcohol anymore. My life was gonna be boring and all that. My life is more fun now at 45 years old, sober, 22 and a half years, than I have ever had fun in my entire life. Hand to God, I swear. And it could be the same for you. I don't care if you're 15 or 50 or 70 or 12, like I was when I first started drinking. Reach out, get some help. I get messages every day from people that say, I don't know how to help my brother. I don't know how to help this. I don't know how to help that. There are sister programs to 12-step programs for friends and family members of alcoholics and addicts. Seek them out. They are in your town. They are in every town. If you can't find them, there's online forums. There's books. There's programs. I will list some resources for you below where you can find these things. If you don't think that you have a problem with drugs or alcohol, but you think maybe it might be a problem, there are ways, there are tests online that you can, could I possibly be an alcoholic? Google that. Could I possibly be an addict? And there will be tests. Take the test, see what it tells you. A lot of people do that, and a lot of people find their way to sobriety. It's the greatest thing in the entire world. I asked a friend of mine to tell her story from a female point of view, another friend of mine that I have in sobriety. Her name is Leslie. I'm gonna link her video below just so you can hear a different perspective. You guys are amazing. I love your comments. I love the interaction I have with you, and I would never have any of that if I weren't sober today. I am so, so grateful for the life that I have. I love you guys, and I'll talk to you later. Bye.